In 1965, as part of the War on Poverty, the US launched an experiment in providing widespread public preschool for 3 to 5-year-olds. Later dubbed Head Start, the program was aimed at helping disadvantaged children escape poverty, and it provided early childhood education as well as health and nutrition services. More than 50 years later, the program serves more than 1 million children at a cost of $10 billion per year and remains widely popular. But has Head Start achieved its goal of increasing life opportunities for children? Convincing evidence of its effectiveness has been elusive due to data and measurement constraints. This paper tackles that by using large-scale administrative data to estimate Head Start's long-term effects on human capital and economic self-sufficiency. The data span nearly 22.5 million children born between 1950 and 1980 and result in a sample that is 10,000 times larger than the surveys that are typically used. For each child in the data, the authors observe their exact date of birth and county of birth. This allows them to estimate the causal effect of Head Start by leveraging 2 sources of variation. First, they exploit the program's county-level rollout between 1965 and 1980. The exact timing of a county's launch depended on many idiosyncratic factors, and, consistent with this, pre-existing local characteristics do not systematically predict when programs were launched. Second, Head Start's age eligibility guidelines provide a natural comparison group in each county. The authors compare the long-term outcomes of children who were eligible for Head Start to the outcomes of children born in the same county who were ineligible. To help visualize this, consider what the pattern of Head Start's effects on adult outcomes might look like. This axis denotes a child's age when Head Start launched in his or her county. This cohort was born 10 years after Head Start began, this cohort was 14 years old when Head Start began, and this line separates the age eligible from the age ineligible. To the right are children who were too old to have directly benefited from Head Start, and to the left are children who were young enough to have Head Start available during their childhood. If the program has a positive causal impact on adult outcomes, we might see a pattern like this: 0 effect on older children, and a level shift for younger children. However, this flat line presumes that Head Start immediately emerged as a full-capacity, mature program. In reality, its capacity grew over time, as did the quality of its services. As such, the effects may look closer to this. There's a trend break at age 6, and the causal impact of the program grows over time as it matures and expands, and only levels off once full implementation has been achieved. And, indeed, that pattern is apparent in the results. Head Start increased the human capital and economic self-sufficiency of disadvantaged children. For both outcomes, there is a clear trend break at age 6, and the estimated effects grow before leveling off for children who had access to the fully implemented program. In terms of magnitudes, Head Start participants experienced an increase in the index of adult human capital of 18% of a standard deviation. They achieved 0.65 more years of education, were 2.7% more likely to complete high school, 8.5% more likely to enroll in college, and had a 39% increase in college completion. Their economic self-sufficiency in adulthood increased by 9% of a standard deviation, with this gain driven by increased employment and reductions in the likelihood of adult poverty and receipt of public assistance. Now, It's worth noting that Head Start is not a model preschool program. In its early years, the priority was on expanding access as quickly as possible, and while its quality has improved over time, it still ranks around the median of the score distribution. Nevertheless, the program has had substantial positive effects. These effects also vary with access to other public programs. Head Start's long-run impact is larger in areas where children have greater access to health services through Medicaid, and is smaller for children with more access to food stamps. This suggests that beyond its preschool curriculum, the program's provision of screenings and referrals to health services, as well as more nutritious meals, are important mechanisms. Finally, the authors quantify the return to dollars spent on Head Start in the 1960s and 70s. Based on the program's impact on potential earnings, they calculate a private internal rate of return of 13.7% and a public internal rate of return ranging from 5.4% to 9.1%. This accounts for the fact that by improving individuals' economic self-sufficiency in adulthood, Head Start reduces public assistance expenditures and creates additional tax revenue from wage gains. As such, not only did the program achieve its goal of reducing adult poverty, it also easily pays for itself and generates sizable returns in the long run. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. These include resources on the history of Head Start, papers studying its short and long-run effects, and research on the cost-effectiveness of public policies.